Hello, my name is Sasha Kasman, and I will be reading to you pictures at an exhibition by Anna Harwell Celenza, accompanied by the music of Modest Mussorgsky. St. Petersburg was a vibrant, bustling city in the 1870s. Business was booming. People took pride in their Russian heritage. It was an exciting time, full of hope and prosperity. Everyone looked to the future with great expectations, especially the city's young artists and musicians. After centuries of exclusion, Russia had finally been embraced by the rest of Europe. Russian culture was all the rage. "It's finally finished!" cried Viktor as he burst through the front door. Modest and Vladimir looked up from the piano. They were playing through a scene from Modest's new opera. "What are you talking about?" asked Vladimir. "My designs for the building competition," said Viktor. "You know, for the city gate in Kiev." He pushed the breakfast dishes to one side and carefully spread his drawing out on the table. "Come have a look," he said. "You'll love it." Vladimir chuckled as he got up from his chair. "No one can accuse you of false modesty, Viktor." Modest nudged Vladimir. "Stop teasing him," he said. "You're the same way when you finish writing one of your articles." He walked over to the table and studied his friend's drawings. "It's fantastic, Viktor. The judges would be fools not to choose your design." "I agree," said Vladimir. "It's magnificent." "Do you really think so?" asked Viktor. "Oh, I hope you're right. It would be a dream come true to finally see one of my designs built in stone." Such was the scene on a sunny March morning in 1873. Modest Mussorgsky, Viktor Hartmann, and Vladimir Stasov were spending the day as they did most days, working together on various projects. They belonged to a group of young artists and musicians trying to make their mark in the world. All three had great plans for the future. Modest wanted to write operas celebrating the glory of the Russian people. Viktor dreamed of decorating his homeland with fantastic towers and gates. And Vladimir hoped to travel far and wide, telling the world about Russia's great talents. But life does not always go as planned, and on July 23, 1873, the lives of these three friends took a turn for the worse.
"No!" cried Modest. "Viktor can't be dead! I saw him just last week!"
"It was quite unexpected," said Vladimir, his voice cracking with sorrow. A blood vessel burst near his heart. Modest's face turned ashen white.
"It's all my fault," he said.
He walked across the room and slumped down in a chair. "Don't blame yourself," said Vladimir. "There was nothing you could have done." Modest buried his face in his hands.
"You're wrong," he cried. "Viktor was complaining of a headache last week, but I wouldn't listen. I wanted him to carry some boxes over to the theater for me. When he refused, I got angry. I called him lazy and said he was faking the headache."
Modest took a bottle from the table next to him and smashed it against the wall.
"Why didn't I listen to him?"
Vladimir tried to comfort his friend, but Modest pushed him away.
"I don't want to talk to anyone," he said. "Just leave me alone."
For the next few weeks, no one saw much of Modest. He hid himself away from friends, suffering the loss of dear Viktor in solitude. When Modest finally did appear, he wasn't the same man. His face was swollen, his hands shook, he was irritable and mean. Modest had stopped writing music, and his friends were worried.
"What are we going to do about Modeste?" asked Alexander, a young composer. "I approached him on the street yesterday, but he wouldn't even look at me." "It hurts to see Modeste suffering like this," said Vladimir. "But there isn't much we can do right now. I'm trying to organize an exhibition of Victor's art. If I can pull it off, perhaps that will help." "Yes," said Mikhail, another friend. "Seeing Victor's art again might just do the trick. If you want help, I'll do everything I can." "Me too," said Alexander. "Just tell me what you need." So Vladimir and the others set to work gathering Victor's art. By February, they had put together a huge exhibition with over 400 paintings and drawings. On the day of the opening, Vladimir visited Modeste and invited him to come. "No!" yelled Modeste. "I'm not interested. Victor is dead, and I want nothing more to do with him. Do you understand?"
"I understand," said Vladimir calmly. He closed the door, locked it, and slid the key into his pocket.
"What do you think you're doing?" cried Modeste.
"I won't take no for an answer," said Vladimir. "Either you agree to come to the exhibition with me now, or you get used to the idea of a roommate."
Modeste narrowed his eyes and sneered. "Have you considered joining the army, Vladimir? You're very good at telling people what to do. I'm sure they would make you a general."
Vladimir crossed his arms and leaned against the door.
"I'm still waiting for an answer," he said. Modeste threw his hands in the air. "All right, you win. I'll come with you. Just let me get my coat."
When they reached the gallery, Vladimir put his arm around his friend's shoulders and said, "A special part of Victor still lives in each of us, Modeste. Don't shut him out. Remember Victor, and the pain of his passing will ease."
"If I have to do this, then at least let me do it alone," replied Modeste.
He pulled away from Vladimir, opened the door to the gallery, and grudgingly stepped inside.
Modeste stood dumbfounded. Every inch was filled with Victor's hopes and dreams, his fears, and his greatest triumphs. Modeste looked across the room and spotted a familiar face, a gnarled little gnome Victor had drawn several years ago. Slowly, he made his way toward the drawing. He stared into the gnome's anxious eyes.
"I know just how you feel," he whispered.
As he wandered through the gallery, each picture sparked a memory. There was a gloomy castle made for one of Mikhail's operas, and designs for some canary costumes used in a ballet. The next painting showed a park in Paris. Lovers strolled beneath the trees while children squabbled next to a swing. That carefree day was so long ago, Modeste thought to himself. There were many portraits in the exhibition, faces both familiar and strange. The wealthy Samuel Goldenberg with his fur hat and arrogant sneer, and Shmuel, the old beggar, crying in the street. There was a painting of the wary peasants Victor and Modeste had seen on the roadway last year, lumbering through the mud with their oxen. Victor's whole life was alive on canvas, from the early morning bustle of the marketplace to the still, dark shadows of the candlelit catacombs. Even Baba Yaga, the witch, was there, from Victor's favorite fairy tale, sitting in her hut built on chicken legs. Each picture was special, but one picture in particular, the Great Gate of Kiev, stirred Modeste's soul. "Oh, Victor," he sighed, "this was to be your greatest achievement, a glorious monument to heroic Russia and Almighty God." Modeste's eyes filled with tears. "Now it'll never be more than a dream. If only I could build it for you." Modeste stood in front of the drawing for a long time. He studied the delicate windows of the church and imagined the stone walls rising heroically toward heaven.
Suddenly, a smile spread across his lips. Maybe I can build it for you, he thought. Modeste rushed from the gallery. Thank you, General, he cried out happily behind him. Modeste went straight to his piano. He hadn't played a note in months, but suddenly his heart was full of music. Modeste thought about Victor's art, and one by one the spirit of each picture filled the room. The anxious gnome appeared first. He scampered out of the piano and scurried across the room in a feverish dance, then stealthily crept along the floor before running away. Rose from the piano, and an ancient castle appeared. A lone troubadour sat at the gate, singing a slow, sad song from ages past. Thank you. Modeste listened for a while, but then his mind began to wander to another part of the exhibition. A ray of sun broke through the mist, and the castle was transformed into a beautiful park full of birds and jeering children. "Na na, na na," they cried as they chased one another around a tree. Modeste laughed at their sing-song jeers. In an instant, they were gone, replaced by plodding oxen, straining under the weight of a heavy load.
Thank you.
chirped the canary chicks. As Modeste played, they hopped out of the piano and scampered across the room. Peep, peep! Fluttering and pecking, they tried desperately to break free from their shells. Mr. Goldenberg was not amused. He stepped out of the piano and looked about the room with an arrogant sneer on his face. Obviously dissatisfied, he slowly walked across the room and out the door, ignoring poor Schmuel, who stood whimpering in the corner. Next, whispering gossip on their way into town. Thank you. didn't seem to hear the mournful tones that rose from the dark catacombs beneath the street. Baba Yaga heard them. The song of death was music to her ears. She leapt from the piano in her monstrous hut and thrashed about frantically looking for children to terrify.
Thank you.
Growing in strength and emotion, each picture filled the room with music as a special part of Viktor came to life. "Now we shall build your great gate of Kiev," cried Modest. He lifted his hands slowly and then slammed them down on the keyboard over and over. Mighty chords rose majestically toward heaven in a hymn of thanks. Heroic Russia and the glory of God combined. Modest worked at his piano, blending the musical pictures into a special composition. He even added a picture of himself, walking through the gallery from one painting to the next. When the composition was finally finished, he closed the music and carefully wrote the title across the front page, "Pictures at an Exhibition." He slid the music into an envelope and sent it to Vladimir with the following inscription: "To the great general, sponsor of the Hartmann Exhibition, in memory of dear Viktor, June 27th, 1874. In the years that followed, Modest returned to his operas and friends. With Viktor alive in him, he followed his dreams with great success. Vladimir also followed his dreams. He traveled far and wide, from St. Petersburg to Paris and Berlin. And in every city, he told people about pictures at an exhibition, making sure that Viktor lived forever in the music of Modest Mussorgsky.